Hello and welcome everyone. My name is Sappho and I want to say thank you to Dr. Oyindamola for the opportunity to interact with you guys on this channel. Now, today we'll be discussing a very important and interesting topic, especially for us as Christian youth. And what we are talking about will be, is holiness still a thing in this generation? Right, so in preparing for this discussion or this study, I looked at the biblical definition from a Bible dictionary of what holiness really is, because we all have an idea what it means. We have an idea what it means, but I checked the Bible dictionary, and the Bible dictionary defines holiness as a word translated from the Hebrew root, which means separateness or withdrawal. And it also becomes further clear in the New Testament, according to the Bible dictionary, that holiness means the pure, loving nature of God that is separate from evil, aggressively seeking to universalize itself, and that this character is inherent in places, times, and institutions intimately associated with worship, and that holiness is to characterize human beings who have entered into personal relationship with God. And I found that definition very, very interesting and consistent with scripture, because we understand that it has always been God's plan for man to be exactly like him, for man to think like him, to live like him. That is why we read in Genesis chapter 1 verse 26 that God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, so that he may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God's plan and intention has always been that man will be like him, that man will also have the same kind of dominion that he has. Romans 8:29 also tells us that for those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. But as we learn from Genesis chapter 3, we know that sin, and more specifically the knowledge of sin, separated man from God. But despite that seeming setback, God's plan for man never changed. God still wanted us to be separate from the world and to be more and more like him and to live like him. So his standards didn't change and his plan didn't change. That is why we read in John chapter 1 verse 11 to 13 that he came, Jesus Christ came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. Jesus himself said in Matthew chapter 5 from verse 17, "I do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them." Verse 19 again, he reiterates, "Therefore, anyone who sets aside any one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven." So God's standards have not changed, and Jesus confirms that for us to know that he rather came to provide a way for us to be able to meet the standards that God has always had for us from the beginning of time, from when he made us, to live like him and to exist like him, to think like him, to act like him, and to have dominion like him. And that is what sets us apart from the world. That is what, as we learn from the definition, makes us separate or makes us withdrawn from the world. And that is the nature of God, that he expects that anything that enters into personal relationship with him should have that nature. And that nature is what we call holiness. So by default, that means that we as children of God and joint heirs with Christ, in demonstrating the very nature of God, we are called to be visibly different from those who are in the world. In the sense that our will, our thoughts, our actions, our words, our attitude, our understanding, everything that we do should be consistent with God's nature through his Holy Spirit that is at work within us. And that's how the world will know the family that we come from. The fact that we are born of God, we are children of God. And that is true holiness, to become more like God and less like the world. This is consistent with how God does his things. In the history of man, whoever God has called, he has set apart from those around him. Abraham was called out of his nation, out from his family, away from his people. When God selected Abraham, he asked him to go away to move from where he was into a new land where he would show him. That was him calling him to be separate from the world in which he found himself. Same thing with Israel, his people. When he heard their cry in Egypt and he delivered them, he didn't deliver them and leave them in Egypt, but he called them out of Egypt into a promised land, which was called Canaan. And that was him separating them from Egypt, from the world that they were accustomed and used to, and taking them to a new place where they could live the kind of life that he had in mind for them, away from the influence of the world and the masters that they used to serve. The same thing happened with the disciples of Jesus Christ. They were all engaged in their different activities. They all had different lives that they were living. But after they encountered Jesus, after they came into contact with him and were called by him, they left everything that they had and they followed him. They followed him. So Jesus tells us that if anyone is to be his disciple, he must first deny himself, pick up his cross, and follow him. That is the separation that holiness calls us to. So Jesus himself is a perfect example, isn't it? He himself grew up with his family, with his mom and his dad, and took up after his dad in the business. But when the time for his ministry came, he was set apart and he did things differently. He didn't move with his family again. He moved with a new set of people, and he was always on the move and doing the will of God. And that made him different. That separated him from those around him. So to answer the question, absolutely, holiness is still a thing in this generation. As long as we affirm that we too, as children of God, as it says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9, that we are a chosen generation, that we are a royal priesthood, that we are a holy nation, that we are his own special people, that we may proclaim the praises of him who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. If we make this confession and if we affirm this to be true in our lives, then we must also accept the part that says that we are called out of darkness. So we are called out of the world, sanctified by God, and sent back into the world to change the world. And that is what holiness really looks like. So salvation that God gives us is definitely a gift, but holiness is what God calls us to after he has given us this salvation. And that is why we need the grace of God. The grace of God is not an excuse for sin, but rather it's an avenue for transformation of the old man that we were into the new man who is separate from the world. So as we read from Titus 2, 11 to 14, for the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. What is good by whose standards? By God's standards. Then, if we are called to holiness, then what is holiness at all? What isn't holiness at all? So holiness isn't going to church regularly or frequently. It is good to go to church, but that is not what defines holiness. Holiness is not being a leader in your church, not being a deacon, an usher, an elder, a chorister. This is not what makes you holy in God's sight. These things are good, but these are not what define holiness. Holiness is not giving huge offerings in church. Holiness is not when they are calling out for seed sowers and you stand up and they mention your name and you give the biggest amount and everybody applauds for you. It is good, but that is not what God calls holiness. Holiness is not knowing the Bible from front to back, that you can quote scriptures from Genesis to Revelation. If it doesn't affect your life and it is not seen in your actions and in your lifestyle, it is not holiness. It is not quoting the Bible at all. Quoting the Bible is not holiness. Holiness is not about how you wear long dresses, how you tie a scarf as a lady, how you don't wear makeup, and how you judge everybody that does those things. That is not holiness. Holiness also doesn't mean that you have never spoken to a person of the opposite sex, or you have never been in a relationship with anybody. As for you, the moment you will talk to someone of the opposite sex is the day of your marriage. That is not the definition of holiness. at all, young people. If you don't agree with me, you may leave a comment down there and let's talk about it some more in the comments. The point I'm making is that holiness is not business where you do something for God to pay you back. Holiness is not, oh, if I do this, if I do more of that, then God will pay me back. No, that is not the definition of holiness. So then what is holiness? Holiness simply means doing the will of God, that is demonstrating the fruits of the Spirit in your life and living the Zoe life, which is the life of God within you. And what is the fruit of the Spirit? From Galatians 5, understand that the fruit of the Spirit is love, it is joy, it is peace, it is patience, it is kindness, it is goodness, it is faithfulness, it is gentleness, it is self-control. This is the fruit of the Spirit. And this is what you see as a life of holiness. That is different from the rest of the world. So to give love, to give forgiveness to people who don't deserve it, not to allow people to rent space in your head and to live there, and for you to hold malice, bitterness, envy, anger, pride in your heart against such people. Holiness is to let go of all those things and to, as far as it depends on you, as the Bible says in Hebrews 12, to live at peace with all men. That is a sign of someone who is holy. Holiness also means that you should have patience with people, that you understand that people will have flaws. If people have flaws, then what we can do for them is to extend the same grace towards them that Christ extended towards us, and to have patience with them as they also grow. And as we do these things, naturally, once we as children of God begin to demonstrate the nature of God in our actions, definitely we will also see the benefits of being children of God in our world. As long as we understand that we are separate from the world, then the conditions of the world will also not affect us. That the dangers and the troubles that we have in the world, even though they may come at us, the Bible tells us that even though the enemy may rise against us as a flood, the Lord will lift up a standard against him. And that is the hope that we have, that once we are separate and we are called out and that we are withdrawn from the rest of the world, we do not suffer as the rest of the world suffers. We do not think as the rest of the world thinks. We don't make the same confessions that the rest of the world makes. So the Bible tells us that where others say there is a casting down, we will say that there is a lifting up. And this is the nature of someone who is holy. And this is what Christ is calling us to. And this is what our challenge is as young people who are coming up on fire for the Lord. This is what God is doing within us, as long as we open up ourselves and allow him to. So today I want to throw the opportunity to anyone out there who may not have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, even though you might have heard about him, or even if you have not, I want to call you to this different life, to call you to this higher living in Christ Jesus, this life of holiness, this life that leaves a mark wherever you find yourself, to become more and more like Jesus Christ, and to have his nature and to dominate your world like him. I charge you and I urge you to accept the Lord Jesus Christ into your life and allow him to start this process with you. And trust me, he will never fail you. I trust that you've been blessed. If you have anything to say, you can drop it down in the comments. And so thank you for listening to me. And God richly bless you as you make up your mind to live your life as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord. Do enjoy your week. Bye.